I can't get started without my clicker. You saw how attached I was to it yesterday, right? Okay, while I'm getting my clicker, I'm going to turn this on. What does that say?
Drinks.
I know. I wish this were a later night video. All right, so drinks. How many different words can you think of for the word drinks if you were putting it on a menu? Somebody give me another word. I heard cocktails, libations, refreshments. Beverages. Any others? What?
Snort.
Snort? Really? Is that a Vermont word? Am I showing my ignorance? Okay. That's a neat word. What else? Anybody have any other ones? Spirits?
Spirits?
Yeah? What?
Tipple.
Tipple. You are a walking thesaurus, my friend. Okay. Do you know what it says on the room service menu here in the Hilton Burlington? It says liquids. I'm not kidding you, it says liquids, which is very scientific, right? And not exactly appealing. I mean, that's on the breakfast menu. Under there, coffee, you know, juice, tea, whatever. And they said liquids. So I pictured whoever was writing that menu, sat down and said, okay, beverages is too trite. You know, I don't like drinks because it's morning. Liquids, that'll work. So anyway, liquids. We'll have to all write to Starwood and say, well, let's cut out the liquids thing in the morning. That's not good. Okay, how about this word?
Tranquil.
Calm.
Relaxing.
Quiet. Ooh, restorative. We have another thesaurus over on the right over here. What else? That's it? We stopped at 3 or 4? Oh, I'm going to be handing out thesauruses today. Restful. I like restful. Okay. How about this? Great beds. Now, how would you describe great beds? I need other words for that. What makes a bed great? Comfortable? Soft? Or firm, right? True, and that's a really good point, the hard and soft, because great and something being a great bed means different things to different people, right? So if you're writing a brochure and you say, we have nice firm mattresses, someone might go, ooh, I like a soft mattress. That's not appealing to me, right? So how do you describe great beds without actually saying that they're firm or soft or giving an impression so that you might turn someone off?
Well, clean.
Clean is very helpful. Free of bed bugs, also helpful, right? That's helpful.
Comfortable.
New. Restful.
New. Restful.
Restorative.
Right? Restorative. What's the feeling you get when you climb into bed at night after you've had a long day?
Cozy
and ah. I like ah.
Snuggly.
I like snuggly as well. How about beds being sumptuous? Right? What? Encapsulating? I don't know, but it sounds like it should be a word. That's a really good word. So here's the deal. I don't know how many people are in this room, like 20 or 30 or something like that. And we all have a whole bunch of different ideas on how to describe certain things. So, and it changes per person. One person might have a more extensive vocabulary than someone else. Someone else might, I think of getting into bed at the end of the night, you know, right before I'm going to bed, and I think, ah, just like you do. Sometimes I think that in the middle of the day, like, I can't wait until I get home, and ah, like right into my bed, which is fantastic. But the idea of coming up with words to say what you mean is not something you can do quickly. I don't know anybody who can think on their feet quickly enough to find exactly the right word in 1 second all the time. So it takes a little bit of thought. When you're trying to persuade someone with writing, there are two main parts to how you have to think about writing. And 50% of the time that you spend, and this is where I think people get tripped up, is in thinking about what you're going to say. And really giving some thought to how you want to position things and how you want your reader to feel and what you want them to take away. And the other 50% then is in figuring out what specific words are going to reflect that. So this takes a lot longer than you would normally think. So I'm going to ask this question. How many people in this room think that they're a really strong writer? It's okay if you think you're a strong writer. You're allowed to admit it. Okay, we have one. Only one of you. Two of you? You were my thesaurus on this side of the room, and my thesaurus on this side of the room. Okay, great. So that works. This is one of the things that will help you become a better writer, is understanding that the process is not writing. The process is more thinking and more ensuring that you're going to create the imagery, create the visual, and capture the person with whatever it is you put down on paper. when you are writing, the main key to making sure that you understand how you want to position all of the information you're trying to deliver is to know your audience. That's the biggest one. You have to know who you're writing to, and that changes. Sometimes you know who they are, generally speaking, but you don't know them personally. You know you're writing to your potential customers, or you know you're writing, you know, you're doing an ad for a newspaper, so you generally know who's going to be reading it, but you don't know what kind of day they've had, and you don't know what their challenges are facing in life. You don't know how much money they have. You don't know how they feel about you, how they feel about travel, how they feel about Vermont. So you can't really get inside their head because you don't know specifically what they're thinking at that moment. So you have to make some assumptions based on that, based on who you think they are and what you think they're looking to hear from you, and then find the words that are going to deliver that message appropriately. You also have to know your goal, and in some of the one-on-one writing seminars that I teach, I do find that often we'll sit down and let's say, I have to write a letter to a guest. And okay, what do you need to do? Well, I have to respond to their complaint. I have to respond to their comment. But what's your goal? The goal is not to respond. The goal is to what? Change their behavior, change their opinion, solve their problem. The goal is not the writing of the thing. The goal is the effect that you're ultimately going to have on whoever that is. And so really understanding your goal will help you in a lot of ways figure out how you need to start, and more importantly with that document, whatever it is you're producing, how you need to finish and where you're going to end up with that reader. You have to choose your words with care. We're going to spend a lot of time on this today. I'm going to be putting you guys to work today. Does everybody have paper to do some writing? Okay, I have extra up here. So if you don't, we'll pass them around a little bit today. Did that make you nervous now that we're actually going to do exercises? Jazz hands was easier? Okay. There are some elements of writing, and for those of you who, I don't know if anybody here attended the workshop last year, we did a writing workshop here last year, and when the VTIC asked me to do it again, I was thinking, okay, well, know your audience. Probably some of you came to last year's and now are expecting whatever the next level of writing workshop, you know, is going to be, and some of you are new, so I tried to put something together today that blended the two, so if you'll have to work with me here. Some of it is basic, and then some of it is sort of the next level, so hopefully we can get through this together. So the elements of writing. When you are writing something, these are all of the elements that you need to take into consideration. The tone of what you're saying, the word selection, which is really important, the desired imagery. I will bet that when you sit down to write something, how many people procrastinate when they have to write something they're not interested in? Come on. Even I would be raising my hand for that one. Come on. You don't want to. So you have to not think of it as a boring exercise. You have to think of it as creating imagery. Writing is creating imagery. And the way, you know, they always say a picture is worth 1,000 words? There's a reason that came into being. Wait till you see what our Jazz Hands video does for people later. They're all going to want to go to the next writing workshop, I'm sure, after they see that. But how do you create that same imagery by using words and not by using photos? It's almost like by using photos, you're cheating a little bit, because that's easier. But to describe whatever that image would be and plant that image in a person's head, whoever's reading what you're writing, that's the harder part. And that's what you really want to get to. The length, the visual appeal, and the organization are all sort of technical aspects of it. How many of you like to read really long letters? Right? You know when someone sends you an email and you actually have to print it out because it's too long for you to read it on the screen? Not good. It's really hard to capture somebody's attention all the way down to the bottom of that email. And so we don't like it when we get them, and yet we do it too. So you have to think mostly about the length and trying to shorten what you do. And some of the tips I'm going to give you all in a little bit are going to help you figure out how to make your words shorter, how to make your phrases shorter, and how to choose more meaningful words. Okay, so I think this might be the last sort of like technical slide here. Why should you adapt your writing style? And I have been interviewing people for jobs for, I don't know, in PR for like 20 years, right? So especially the kids who come right out of college. They're so cute. They come and they sit in my, first they tell me they want to work in PR because they love working with the public, which we don't do. So that sort of knocks them out right away because I know they truly do not understand PR because we don't work with the public. Then they tell me that they're people. I'm a people person, which is great. Always helpful in any job. You could work at the Gap and take care of those two things that I just mentioned, right? Loving the public and work. Who loves to work with the public anyway? But anyway, and working with people. So we have that. But then the other thing they always say is I ask them about their writing style, and I find it fascinating that most kids coming right out of college tell me about their writing style, like they have a writing style. So I like to write this way, or I like to write that way. If you want to be an exceptional writer, you should not have a writing style at all. Your writing style should change all the time based on what you're writing, who you're writing to, what you're trying to say, what's going on in the world today. Something that I might send out that's fun and exciting in terms of a news announcement might take on a very different tone if it was the day after September 11th and I needed to make the same announcement. There's more gravity involved, there's a different sort of positioning that might be involved. It wouldn't be as fun, it wouldn't be as playful. And I think that kind of thing happens a lot. There is, I'm sure, are there Red Sox fans in here?
Yes.
Okay, are there any Yankee fans in here? Okay, good. Okay, I'm not a Yankee fan, so I'm not a Yankee fan. I will admit, here you go, sweetheart. You got the chocolate for admitting it in a room full of Red Sox fans, okay? I know, there's so many other surprises in this little box today. So we had to write a press release when the Red Sox first won the World Series, not back in 1918, but first recently won the World Series. We were doing some work for the New England Inns and Resorts Association, and we put together this package. It was ready to go live the night that the last game was being played. So we had two sets. We asked all of the properties around New England to come up with packages. One set of packages would be if the Red Sox won, and they would be world champion getaway packages. And the other set was if they lost, and they were going to be lick your wounds, I think, or no, it's always next year. There's always next year packages. And so it was ready to go. Both things were ready to go. And whenever the last out went, they flipped it on, and we put up the packages and publicized it, and it was fantastic. The difference between the tone of those two press releases was incredible. Writing the same, and it was one of those things where I felt like I was in a sci-fi movie. I was writing about the future, if it would take two different paths. One was joyful and excited and had fun photos, and the other one was sort of really sad, and there was a lot of nods to the Bambino and like all this other stuff. I learned a lot about Red Sox folklore that year, that's for sure. So adapting the writing style to make sure that you're reflecting the appropriate tone and what the audience is going to be expecting of you is a huge, huge key to making sure that your writing is influential and persuasive. It is the one area of communication and interaction that you can control. You can't control if someone's in a bad mood when they receive it. You can't control if they just had a fight with their spouse that morning, or if they're angry about something, or if they're super happy about something and really receptive. So you can control how you position it, and that's important because you can't always control what the receiver's going through. If you communicate more effectively, you will have to do less of it. Did you watch Sesame Street? Or maybe it was the Electric Company. Did you watch the Electric Company when you were little?
Yes.
Am I dating myself that I watched the Electric Company when I was little? So, with your kids, right? So the Electric Company had this really fun skit. For those of you who don't know, they had these little skits all the time. It was kind of like Sesame Street. They would do random little things and show different photos and fun music and stuff. I think I learned my ABCs from the Electric Company or something. And they had this really fun skit where a guy walked into a diner and sat down on the stool. Some of you might remember this one. And said, hey, I'll have orange juice and a sweet roll. And the guy said, well, we're out of sweet rolls. So the guy says, well, okay, then I'll have coffee and a sweet roll. So the guy behind the counter says, well, I'm sorry, sir, we're out of sweet rolls. All right, well, then I'll have cranberry juice and a sweet roll. And the guy, of course, and when I was five, I thought this was hilarious. Right? But it ended up, of course, with the guy standing on a stool going like, we are out of sweet rolls. And I feel sometimes like with the writing, when you're not communicating effectively, you just end up saying the same thing over and over and over again just to try to get through. But if you're not changing the way you say it, you're not responding in a different way, you're not positioning in a different way, you're not going to have a change in the effect of the person who's reading your information because you're just saying the same thing over and over again. So the more that you communicate effectively and showcasing your brand in a tailored way, making sure that you're positioning things in a way that makes sense for your brand, you will ultimately get what you want, which this is what it's all about, right? Getting what you want. It's dangerous to be friends with me or be my business partner, hello, jazz hands, because you can end up making sure that you write something in a way that leads the reader to the inevitable conclusion of, I need to do whatever this person is asking me to do. And so that's what I hope we're going to leave you here with today after we get through all these things. So we have seven strategies today, and this is where we're going to start doing a few exercises together. Seven strategies that you can use to improve your writing starting right now. Number one, we talked about this a minute ago, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. Knowing your goal. Well, two things I think that are important here. What is a stated goal and what is the hidden goal? Often what happens is you have a guest books an experience or a hotel room with you, and you need to send them a confirmation letter. So the stated goal is that you need to send them a confirmation letter. You have details you need to send them. The hidden goal is that you want to already make them start loving you from the minute you send that. So how are you going to upsell stuff to them? How are you going to let them know what's going on in the community? How are you going to get them to be involved in whatever your brand messaging is? There are other things that you need to accomplish. When you are responding to a guest comment in some way, you want to A, respond to their comment, but B, at the same time, you want to make them an evangelist for you. You want to solve their problem. You want to make sure that you inspire word of mouth and getting them to talk about other people, talk about your brand with other people. And so understanding that you often have a couple of different objectives every time you write something is super important. When you sit down to write something, have you guys ever done this? You sit down to your computer and you go, I do that a lot. They say, you remember I talked about the dog look yesterday with my face? Yeah, I do that. I have a wall that is pure windows in front of my office, so anybody walking towards me can see me as I'm sitting at my desk, and the staff in my office comments all the time that this is me. I literally, at least 6 times a day. And usually I'm staring at the ceiling, trying to figure out what I want to say. And that seems to be my pose, my I'm thinking of what I want to say pose. And you might have an I'm thinking of what I want to say pose as well. But the important thing is that when I'm having trouble and I'm not really able to focus on what I need to do, I find that the reason that is, and this might be a challenge for you too, is that I'm already trying to wordsmith as the words are coming out of my mouth, out of my brain. And that's not good, because it clutters you. You gotta just let the concepts flow first, and you can make them sound good after. So if you get stuck when you're about to try to write something, stop what you're doing, jot them down. I'm a huge fan of mechanical pencils and a little post-it. Jot down a few words, or stream of consciousness. Just start typing nonsense words that are coming out of your brain, and let it all flow. And then after a while, you can go back and look at what you have, and figure out how you want to organize that into something that is a little bit more sensible. You have to get in your audience's shoes. And these three examples, the three different words, comfy, comfortable, sumptuous, we talked about that kind of thing with the beds. If you say that something's comfy, it implies very informal, casual. Comfortable is kind of middle of the road. Sumptuous is probably luxurious and a little bit more elegant. Probably also indicates it's more expensive. Right? It has that connotation surrounding it. We're going to talk a lot about the connotations of words today. If you have a restaurant, we have a restaurant over here, My Thesaurus. Great grub, delicious meals, or decadent fare. Completely different in the way that they're positioning. And you feel like, if I'm a reader and I read that, I immediately think about, how do I need to dress when I go to this place? What is the average check price probably going to be? And the difference between all these places? Are they going to have a good wine selection? I'm thinking the Great Grub place probably wouldn't have one. Big wine selection. The Decadent Fair place better have one. A really good wine selection, right? And so just with those little words, all of these other images come into your head. And so as writers, we need to be very mindful about the words that we choose, because every time we choose a word like that, we're also planting other imagery at the same time. There's a difference between if somebody already knows you or they're meeting you for the first time, the way you would talk to them, yesterday we bonded over donuts, and so I felt very comfortable asking you all to come up here and do jazz hands with me. If I was just meeting you today, I'm not so sure I would have done that. And if you know what they're thinking, if you know what's going on in their minds, and you know what challenges they're facing, you can find the right words to cut through the clutter of whatever they're facing and get their attention. Moms, today. Somebody describe a mother of four today.
Crazy.
For having the kids or now that she has the kids, right? Bald. Okay. What else?
Stressed.
Exhausted. Stressed.
Frazzled.
Many balls in the air.
Many balls in the air. Is she happy? Because this doesn't sound very happy to me. She might be happy, but maybe not. Is she regretful that she has this horribly crazy, stressed life?
Maybe.
Not necessarily.
If she's balanced, she would be happy.
If she's balanced, how do we know if she's balanced? We don't, right? Can we make any other assumptions about today's soccer mom? Are you good? Do you guys have soccer moms up here? Or are there like lacrosse moms? Or almost, you're almost at the border of hockey moms?
It sort of depends on what your product is. Mm-hmm. Like if your product is about solving a problem that one perceives that mother group to have, mm-hmm. and then maybe your product is all about reinforcing how happy and joyful it is to have a house mm-hmm. full of kids.
Right. Or if you don't, if you're not happy and joyful about having a house full of kids, here's how you can escape them. That could be a whole nother, right? You know, so it a lot of it depends on whether or not you know your audience or whether or not you can make any kind of generalizations about your audience. And you can't always do that, and it's risky to take some assumptions because of what we just said, the firm and the soft mattress. It's very risky to make assumptions about how people are going to think. So you need to be choosing words. I promise you we're going to get to the exercises today. You need to be choosing words that in some way are persuasive and influential and positive, create a positive feeling, but without casting any kind of judgment on their feeling, what they're thinking, what they're likely to be doing, because nobody likes that. Choose meaningful words. How many people have been in a writing seminar with me before? Okay, so a few of you. Does anybody remember the words you're absolutely not ever allowed to use again?
I.
Okay, well, that's good. Start with I.
No.
Great. You're still getting chocolate? Great. I love that. Uh-huh.
The best.
The best, right? Okay, what? Great. Yes. Okay, so for those of you who have not been in a writing seminar with me before, there are some words that I recommend that you don't use regularly, and they are what I would call abstract or empty words. They're not concrete words. They don't say anything. Best, great, phenomenal, awesome. You can add these to it too. Really, extremely, very. These are all cheating words. Really, extremely, and very are cheating words. It's like I haven't really taken the time to find the word that I want, so I'm going to just pick a word that I know, and I'm going to add very in front of it, and that's going to make it sound stronger. And if I really feel like making it stronger, I'm going to add 5 exclamation points at the end of it. And that's going to give you a fantastic idea of how passionate I am about this particular word. And so the same thing with best, great, phenomenal, and awesome. Let's say I said, I have the best restaurant in town. What does that mean?
According to?
According to who, first of all. And what does that mean? Does it mean my food is delicious? Does it mean my service is exceptional? What does it mean? So all of these words, when you say we are great or we are awesome or the view from our patio is awesome, awesome is, the literal sense of the word awesome is inspiring awe. So when you say your food is awesome, like do you really expect people to be like, oh, you know, oh my God, this is the best food I've ever eaten. I think words have taken on a different meaning over time, so it doesn't, obviously, you don't expect anyone to do that. It'd be great if they did. So you need to find a way to use precise words that say exactly what you mean. Those words, great, phenomenal, awesome, best, they don't inspire any imagery. So they're kind of wasted words, especially if you're using them as part of a tagline, which I see a lot. You know, when you use a tagline, have a tagline that has the word best in it, the best restaurant in town, or the best hotel in town, or the best attraction in the state of Vermont. It's not making a connection with someone, and it's not making them feel like they understand why you would be the best to them, because it means different things to different people. Total sidebar. I was a philosophy minor in college, and we spent an entire semester studying the word beautiful. I think this is where I got my writing, my interest in writing. And we had 10 different essays to write, and every essay we wrote had to be a different perception of the word beautiful in some way. It was a lot of writing. But it really made me think at the end to, you know, how a baby can be beautiful, and a sunset can be beautiful, and porpoises doing, or even sometimes a junkyard could be beautiful, depending on where and why, and you know, if someone is about to create sculpture out of it that's going to reinvent what they have, I mean, that could all be beautiful. So using different words to describe what we mean when we say things like beautiful or best make a huge difference in terms of the impact it's going to have on the reader. Look how interesting this is. Really important. If something is really important, It could be essential, or it could be vital. Extremely helpful staff could be resourceful or gracious. Both say different things. If you say that someone's really, you know, really helpful or extremely helpful, there's different reasons for that. And I think angry, I'm gonna have to come up with a positive one because I don't like using the angry one, so negative. But anyway, because I'm not angry that often, but somehow I know a lot of angry words. Furious, incensed, and livid. Like if your mom says, I'm livid, man, I'd be running from my room at that point. It's completely different than saying very, very angry. It just doesn't pack the same punch. A thesaurus is your best friend. How many people here have a thesaurus? You do. How many people use a thesaurus? There's a huge difference. I have a few of these handy ones here today. I've adopted this as my new favorite. See how small it is? But there's a gajillion words. What? You do? I'm a little old school. I carry this around with me. I do flip through this every once in a while. I'm such a geek. But anyway, but it's really helpful. So the thesaurus, that's how you conjugate thesaurus, right? Thesaurus, thesauri are really good. So I have a few in here I'm going to give away today. Okay, let's do a sidebar. This is an official sidebar because it made the PowerPoint. I want to talk about patience and perseverance in writing because you will get to a point when you're trying to find the right word and it's not coming and you're going to want to throw in the towel and just be like, damn it, I'm going to use the word very, even though she told me I shouldn't, right? So I'm going to look at a couple of these sentences and then we're going to send you off on your own to do your thing. We have a great selection of rooms from which to choose. Tells me absolutely nothing. Our staff are extremely helpful and can assist you with any of your sightseeing needs. Also extremely nothing. And we have the best restaurant in town. Doesn't really tell me anything. More examples. Here, you will learn the lost art of relaxation. Let's compare. Here, you will rediscover the lost art of relaxation. What's the difference between those two?
One says you never knew it in the past, the other says you knew it in the past, and you're re-knowing it.
One more time?
One says you never knew it in the past, and the other says you knew it in the past, you lost it, and now you're relearning.
Right. So I'm going to give you a thesaurus for that. What does that say in terms of casting judgment on the reader? Right? So I'm a hotel, and I say the one of those two things. What am I saying about the person who's reading that statement? Second one is more positive. And also learning, and let's see if where's the other one? How about discover? It's not quite rediscover. What's the difference between discover and rediscover? Right, you lost it in the first one. But what's the difference between learning and discovering?
The learning is about me teaching you something.
Uh-huh.
The discovering is about you, it's push or pull.
Right. So to your point about this being negative, this sort of says the same thing but in a more positive way, right? More like, because we've created this environment for you, you are going to be able to find your own way, right? And you're going to be able to have all of these things happen to you on your own. Now, what about this? Here you will enjoy the lost art of relaxation. So if we're worried about casting judgment in a way that's going to offend them, we just take that whole discovery, learning thing right out of the equation and we pick a whole new verb and suddenly we're saying something positive, but it's not really casting any judgment because nobody could be faulted for saying you're going to enjoy this, right? How about this one? Here you will appreciate the lost art of relaxation. It's a little bit deeper than enjoying. It's more active. It's more like, as you're there, there's going to be an experience involved in it. You are appreciating it. Appreciating can mean a couple of different things. Appreciating meaning you're going to be grateful that you had it, but appreciate could also mean you're going to enjoy the experience as it's going on. So that creates kind of a different feeling. Now here's kind of a neat one. Here you will adopt the lost art of relaxation, which indicates that you're going to take this with you when you leave in some way. And so all of these things, all of these different examples are fantastic in terms of the way you're communicating that you have the lost art of relaxation captured and you're going to be sharing it with these people. And you could even do that. We are going to share with you the lost art of relaxation. I better stop because I could keep going on with other examples. Let's try even more examples. Whole new strategy, okay? This one is not as happy. So you get a letter from a guest and they're not happy about something and they describe some kind of incident they had. The incident doesn't matter. You respond, I was disturbed when I heard of your situation. Now, number one, we wouldn't be sending this because we don't use the word I, right? You always, and we'll talk about that. We always want to go third party, not I. This is very unfortunate that this happened to you. But let's say we use the word I, just for argument's sake. I was disturbed when I heard of your situation. I was alarmed when I heard of your situation. What's the difference between those two?
More urgency.
More urgency.
Alarmed means you may do something about it. Disturbed means it just bothered you.
It bothered you. Alarmed, it also creates a little bit of, right? There's a little horrification going on with the alarmed portion. I was upset when I heard of your situation. Now think of the guest. I've just complained to you about something. And you have either told me that you're disturbed, alarmed, or upset. Which one is going to matter to me more? Alarmed? Why do you think that? I'm upset too. What did you say over there?
Too personal.
Too personal. I'm going to give her a thesaurus for that. It's too personal because upset is a personal quality. You picture me at my desk either with a tear in my eye or being really angry or something like that, and it shows my emotion. And my emotion shouldn't matter in this particular case. Your emotion should matter, right? So
I don't buy it either. So I wouldn't feel like it's true.
You wouldn't feel like it's true?
Yeah.
I guess it would depend on the rest of the paragraph, right?
I'm upset and disturbed.
Feel like, who cares that you're upset? I'm upset. That's why I wrote you the damn letter, right? How about this? I was concerned when I heard of your situation. Is that a good one? We like the manager of any establishment to be concerned that their people are upset. And think about also the effect that this has on the reader in terms of how is this business handling my complaint in some way. And so if I say, and I think this might be what you were trying to get at before about the alarmed and disturbed portion of it, it almost sounds like the manager is shocked that this was happening under his nose, didn't know, wasn't aware of how the staff was treating people or that these things were happening. And so in a way that kind of makes it look like we're the Keystone Cops without actually saying it. It almost makes it seem like the manager doesn't know what's going on in their own store. So the subtle difference is when you say concerned, it doesn't have that same implication. It says I'm upset about it, but I'm okay. I knew about it in some way. Like it's not quite as shocking. How about I was sad when I heard of your situation? This would sort of be like if your cat was staying with us and it died while you were here. I was sad. That's more appropriate. I was sad when I heard of your situation. Then it's sort of appropriate. I was outraged when I heard of your situation.
Anger's
not a good thing. Unless the guest had something horrible happen to them in town while they were staying with us, not at our hotel, but somewhere else, and we are going to step in and advocate for them. I am outraged that this happened to you, and I am going to do something about it. I like how we created that scenario together. Thank you. Okay, I was disconcerted when I heard that. Do you guys ever use the word disconcerted? People don't use that in everyday language, right? That's somebody who's really formal. So, but did you ever notice how sometimes when we have to write a response to someone like that, we tend to be more formal? And suddenly, like, the real important sounding words start coming out of our mouth that we don't use in everyday language? That's exactly when a word like disconcerting would come up, right?
That's when I think it seems to be insincere.
Right.
Then it's insincere. So one of the lessons we are learning today, if we didn't already know this, is that if you don't write the way you normally speak, it doesn't always sound sincere. Because people don't talk that way. You know, they talk, you can be professional and still be human in the way you talk. That's what the thesaurus is for. Not to find fancier words, but to find the right words, the ones that are really meaningful and say what you want them to say. How about I was distressed when I heard of your situation? I could do 20 slides of these. This is fun, okay? Distressed. Also, a little bit personal, but at the same time, distressed is somehow less impactful than alarmed or upset. It's a little bit more moderate in terms of the way it was sort of, I guess it's sort of saying like, I was upset about it, but I moved on with my day, you know? And so it kind of gives that impression. Okay. Your turn. Who has paper? You guys all have paper. Does anybody need paper? You need some paper? Do we have another one in the back? Yeah? I stole 4 pads from the Hilton. Oh my God, we got that on camera. I stole 4 pads from the Hilton. Sorry, I'll give them back. It's okay, can we edit that part? Okay, for you. And back over here. Oh, you got? I have some of those too. I didn't steal those though. You have? Oh yeah? Oh good, okay. Here, we'll give this to you.
I'm using your.
Oh, you are? Okay, that's good. Okay, you see the 4, everybody have paper? And somebody need a pen still? Yes? Okay. You got pens? Oh, aren't you awesome, thank you. Audience participation. So, there are 4 sentences up here. Vermont is a beautiful state. The skiing in Vermont is awesome, right? Vermont has the friendliest people in New England. Don't tell my friends in New Hampshire that I wrote that. You'll have the best vacation in Vermont. What I would like you to do is pick one of those sentences, whichever one you want, and rewrite it in a way that is significantly more descriptive and tells me, why is Vermont a beautiful state? Why is the skiing awesome? Why are the people the friendliest? And why will you have the best vacation in Vermont? And I don't care if you use more than one sentence. I just want you to provide some kind of a meaningful description that in some way says to me more than just that it's the best, but that I really make a connection with it, and it makes me want to know more, and perhaps makes me want to come to Vermont. So I'm going to give you a couple of minutes. All right. Who wants to go first? I've got a thesaurus for anybody who goes first. Okay, shoot.
The power of majestic mountains and the calm of flowing streams can be found in Vermont.
Okay, the power of majestic mountains. You know what? I'm going to read this for posterity's sake on my little microphone here. So the power of majestic mountains and the calm of flowing streams can be found in Vermont. What does that say to us all? That's like awesome, right? That has the awesome sound to it, like God created this state just for you. Power of majestic, I mean, what visual does that create?
Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Peaceful.
Yes? What?
Peaceful.
Enchanting.
Enchanting.
Come on.
Big and strong.
I'm sorry?
Big and strong.
Big and strong. Doesn't it create sort of a feeling of vastness? Like I'm going to be standing in a little field somewhere, and there'll be a stream flowing behind me, which I'll be able to hear, and I'll be staring at these huge mountains, which are obviously majestic, because that's the way we've described them. It creates a feeling of expansion, and it describes the geography in a way that beautiful doesn't work. So yay for you, you get a thesaurus. Who else has something else? We picked on you already. Can I go to somebody else? Come on, guys. Okay, right here, yeah?
When you visit Vermont, you will experience idyllic towns, view majestic scenery, and participate in quintessential Vermont traditions.
Okay, let's talk about the word quintessential. What does that mean? What?
No, it's
kind of. No, quintessential? Iconic, right? Isn't that hilarious? None of us can describe what the word quintessential means. We use it all the time. You people in Vermont use quintessential all the time. It's like breathing. It has a Norman Rockwell painting to it. You're getting a thesaurus for that. I love that. That's a great way to describe it. You know why? Quintessential really sort of means the embodiment of whatever that experience should be. So when we say quintessential Vermont, we're automatically assuming that people know what Vermont is all about. But because it has such a strong heritage, the way New England has such a strong heritage, I gotta lump you in with New England at this point, quintessential sort of means that feeling of a sort of small, charming, cute town. There's gonna be, you get a picture of a church with a big, huge spire that's like white clapboard, and all the people are really nice, and there's a farmer's market on every corner. Right? Is that what, are we describing the quintessential? Okay, so what was the, and I think I need to read your sentence for the.
You might not be able to read it.
Oh, come on, bring it. Is it the bottom one?
Mm-hmm.
When you visit Vermont, you will experience idyllic towns, view majestic scenery, and participate in quintessential Vermont traditions. I think farmer's market, I think apple picking. You guys have apple picking up here, right? I didn't make that up. Okay, I think apple cider donuts. That's what I think of when I come up here. Your writing is beautiful, by the way. I don't know what you're talking about. So that whole sort of feeling, and what does idyllic tell us? What does idyllic tell us?
Perfect.
Perfect. And calm and tranquil. Yay for you. Tranquil, also picturesque. Idyllic almost also has picturesque attached to it. You get a visual of it. right? Who else has something that has a visual in it?
Vermont will wrap you up in her voluptuous seasons.
You're in luck, though. You're in luck, though. I like that. We need to get you writing on the beds, right? I was very free with my thesauri, so but you're getting chocolate for that one, especially because chocolate has a voluptuous feeling to it. Did you look something up on thesaurus.com?
No.
All right. You swear? You just wrote it down? All right, good. Okay, phew. We almost had scandal at the writing workshop. Right? Who else? I don't have any other things to give out, but I will give you a hug. Who else has something they want to share? Now that you know a prize isn't on the line. Yes.
Be at home in Vermont. A warm New England welcome waits for you here.
Okay. Now, what are you expecting people to get out of that when you say be at home? Go a little further with that for me.
To me, be at home, and I guess I am making a bit of a judgment.
It's okay.
Comfortable, easy, safe. Welcoming, neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I didn't think of state, somebody else did.
And the only thing I will ask, though, is the mom that we described before, does that sound like her home? Right? So when you're saying stuff like that, you need to also further describe it for them so that they understand, especially because Vermont, and I've found this every time I've come up here, I do feel like I'm going to someone's house. I could stop on the side of the road on some of these streets here and walk in and ask one of you all for a glass of water, and I know you'll give it to me, right? Mm-hmm. Right, like those friendly, did you guys hear about the friendly people who were warning me about the state troopers? Mm-hmm. So, idiot New Yorker that I am, these people are all flashing me their brights as I was driving up on Monday, right? And I'm like, oh, are they part of a funeral? Because they're all like coming right after me. And then I passed the state troop, I think it was a state trooper, I think it was local, and I was like, oh, those nice, friendly people in Vermont were trying to warn. We don't do that in New York. So, but I had 30 dozen donuts in my car, so I probably would have been just fine. We would have been down one box by the time I got up here, but I would have been ticket-free. Vermont, when I think of you guys as a community, I do feel like I'm coming to someone's home. So I like that concept very much in order to be able to describe it to people so that they get the same feeling I'm trying to communicate. Who has something else? We gotta have another. Yes. Now that there are no prizes at stake, you can go.
Join us as we share with you our Vermont with its stunning vistas, gently rolling hills, and picturesque towns that you can't find anywhere else.
Excellent. And there's so many visuals created in that. And what I find fascinating in all of the things that you all have been talking about, you've been describing, when I said Vermont is a beautiful state, you all went right to scenery. But beauty could be its people. It could be its experiences. It doesn't necessarily have to mean the rolling hills and the idyllic quintessential towns and all of that stuff. It could mean so many other things. Now, did anybody pick any of the other phrases?
First of all, when someone says you can't find anywhere else, that always, like, if I'm going to look to the Caribbean and they say we've got beaches like nowhere else.
Right. That's so not true.
Pretty quickly.
Right.
You know, I might go to that beach, but
right.
I wonder about that as something that people have to do.
And I agree with you. It's one of the reasons why I'm glad you are all here
Vermont,
today, except in Vermont, where this is the best state in the world, of course. One of the reasons why some of the most successful ads have been the most successful is because they are not saying trite things that could be found anywhere. Look at the Lay's potato chip campaign. Come on. Somebody has to know it.
Can't eat just one.
Thank you. If I had a gift, I would be giving it to you. You can't eat just one. Now, what makes that so good was they're not saying our potato chips are better or they're crispier, because everybody can say that. Their marketing campaign is you can't eat just one, which it doesn't matter if anybody else says it or not. First of all, they said it first, and it's been going on for, they in fact took it away and brought it back because it was sort of backed by popular demand. Everybody wanted it. What's so fantastic about that as a marketing campaign is that it immediately makes you want to eat potato chips. And it also makes you feel like these are the best potato chips without them having to say we're the best potato chips, by the way they describe it. So in some of these things that we're talking about here today and different phrases that we're using, the purpose of meaningful writing and choosing meaningful words that connect with your reader is the challenge of finding words that describe what you want to say, especially when you're talking about marketing, that describe what you want to say that can't really be said by someone else. That's when, remember in the beginning when I talked about how 50% of your time has to be about thinking? That's what you want to be thinking about. You want to be thinking about how can I set myself apart? How can I, especially when you're talking about marketing. So I agree with you. Now, did you do a different sentence?
Skiing in Vermont offers a variety of terrain for everyone to have an incredible day on the mountain.
Yes. What do you mean by incredible? Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah, I think of having a good time, having a fun time on a mountain.
Beat your personal best? What, you know what I mean? Like, let's, what is an incredible day? Can I admit to you guys that I don't ski? Is that bad? Career-ending injury when I was younger. I don't know what I'm talking about. So since, clearly I don't know how to describe skiing, but anyway.
I think with skiing, the biggest challenge is it's awesome. Skiing for everybody is entirely different.
Yeah.
That's why, you know, some people love the very flat terrain.
Yes.
And they also love the really steep pitches. I think the challenge in that line would be trying to write something to appeal to everyone.
So right.
An incredible day for someone that can be,
in pain at the end of the day. An incredible day for me would be hot cocoa in the lodge.
Yes.
Okay. So what's something besides just the majestic terrain, what's something about skiing that everybody who's a skier would find incredible?
Après-ski.
Yeah. Après-ski. Uh-huh.
Fresh air.
Right? Robin's Egg Blue Sky.
Scenery.
What about the quality of the snow?
Snowmaking and grooming in Vermont. That's the only way we've been able to compete at all with the West.
Okay.
If we had to live in the old days, we'd be in.
We would be promoting something else for winter.
Mud.
We'd be promoting mud. Right. Is the quality of the powder? Is it powdery? What kind of snow are we looking for when we want to ski?
That's what you're looking for. But.
Right. Right. Okay.
About having a better day skiing today than you did yesterday. Mm-hmm. I don't know how to say that. Take a while to figure out, but mm-hmm. an incredible day of skiing is, somebody said it, your personal best.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not quite sure how you would say that.
Exhilarating.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Except if someone's exhilarating, you could be going down very steep hill, someone else is exhilarating, being on a bunny slope for the first time.
Right. But exhilarating does it. I mean, even exhilarating actually is a word that is okay to stand on its own because it. You get a little like butterfly in your stomach when you hear the word exhilarating, don't you? Or is it just me? Am I admitting something that I shouldn't be admitting? It makes you sort of feel excited, right? We had somebody else who did a non-Vermont is a beautiful state. I thought I saw a hand over here. Did anybody else not do the first one? Yes.
And feel free to pull this apart.
Oh, great. You guys ready? She's open for suggestions. Okay?
Visit New England, come home to Vermont.
Oh. Isn't that interesting?
It's the third one.
Vermont has the friendliest people in New England. Where's the Vermont tourism people? We should get them up here. I like that one. Oh, well then, there you go. Right? You cheated. That's no fair. Right? But it is true.
I was using great adjectives, and I looked at this and thought, I don't have any,
But
dollar adjectives.
No, but the... What you described, how do you guys feel about that? You feel good about it? It's okay. You're allowed to say you feel good about it. I feel pretty good about it because it actually does what we were trying to do over here in terms of describing what it feels like to be home. What we've done over here is take out of the equation whether or not you like your home or your home is stressful or anything like that. It sort of says, here's all this great stuff going on, and you can enjoy it, and we're happy about our New England neighbors, and yay for them, because they're so lovely. But when you're done with all of that, you can come home to Vermont, and we'll take care of you. It almost feels like the state is hugging you, right, when you do that. Good. That gets my vote for an upcoming new campaign. Well done to you. Who else? Anybody have any other ones? Not? Yes.
Vermonters welcome visitors to share their passion for the outdoors.
Oh, see, in the beginning I was sort of like, I'm not sure where she's going with this sentence, and then we threw in the passion for the outdoors, and what did that just say about the people who live in Vermont?
Healthy.
Healthy? What else? active, right? And also using the word passion for the outdoors also displays the feeling that they're going to inspire that same passion in you. So if I want to lose 10 pounds, I'm going to want to go to Vermont, right? Because the people everywhere I see, they're all going to want to take me out and have me doing something in the outdoors. I love that sentence. If I had something, I'll hug you at the end. If I had something else to give, I can't hug you until they take the mic off of me because then they're going to yell at me. Anybody have anything else? No? Okay, so let's move on. We're continuing our seven strategies. We're on to number four. The important stuff has to go first. Now, do you remember all those kids that I told you were applying for jobs at Red Point right out of school? I would say that more than 50% of them start their cover letter with, "Hi, my name is Mary Jones, and I am looking for a job in PR." And my feeling to that is, thanks, because I saw the name in the email address, and I saw the name at the bottom of the email, and I saw the name at the top of your resume, and all of that stuff. So what that person just did was waste the first two sentences of the letter by telling me something I already know. The first two sentences, first sentence for sure, and if you're talking about emails, the subject line, are absolutely vital and really, really important to make sure that you capture the attention of whoever is reading whatever it is you're sending them. So if you waste the first couple of sentences on stuff that isn't meaningful, or on stuff that they should already know about, stuff that they could get from somewhere else, then you're losing an opportunity to grab them right in the beginning. And that's absolutely important. You have to remember your goal and start pursuing it from word one. Remember we were talking about all those long emails and documents that you get from people? If all of the important stuff is at the bottom, what's the likelihood you're actually going to get there? I did a writing workshop in St. Lucia. We were not on the beach, just so you know. I was in St. Lucia for 5 days, and I saw mostly the inside of a conference room. I did see the beach out of the window, but I didn't get a chance to do it. So in any case, just a little sidebar, let you guys know about that. So I was doing this writing workshop in St. Lucia, and we talked about this, and this was something one of the guys that was in there came up to me afterward and said that he has a big problem with this. I don't like the phrase he used, so I won't use it here. But anyway, so he said that he sits down to write, and it just all comes out. He gets to the end, and then he usually hits send, and he doesn't sleep on it or wait and everything like that. So whatever stream of consciousness goes, sends it right out. He sent me an email this morning. I wish I had the ability to put it up on the screen. He sent me an email this morning, and he wanted my opinion on something. Wrote. There's a million things in there. He wrote at the bottom, "I swear to you." He wrote at the bottom, "I probably lost your attention with all of this. So if you read all the way to the bottom, when you respond to me, start your email with the word boo in big capital letters, and I will know you read all the way to the bottom on this." And I thought, well, isn't he smarty pants, right? But he remembered that that was something that I had suggested he do. He couldn't stop himself from doing what he needed to do, but he wanted to see if I got all the way to the end. So I will respond to him. I got it right before I came in here. I will respond to him, and I will start my sentence, my whole email with boo and make him feel better. So remembering your goal and starting to pursue it from the minute you start to write, because it's like the minute somebody opens, just to say it's an email, the minute somebody opens an email, it's like a clock is ticking. And they're immediately like, I have to go on to the next thing because everybody's so busy. You guys all saw the tension, the snapped rope yesterday, right?
Can you go back to boo for a second?
Yeah, sure.
You said boo and he's excited that you read it all, but you're not happy you had to read it all.
No.
You're not pleased about it. He didn't get his results. You actually did read it, but
yes.
He didn't make a friend. He didn't make a sale by doing it.
So no, but in his case, it was okay because he was asking my advice on well, you guys should probably hear about this. How many people here do Facebook posts for your brand? Right? Okay. And we talked about this yesterday. You all love doing it, right? So, except you. I know you love doing it. he works for the St. Lucia Tourist Board, and he was asking me my opinion on whether or not he should post when the weather is rainy down there. Because is that good for tourism, to show that it's raining in St. Lucia? Well, everybody knows it rains everywhere. I'm sorry. So he was asking my opinion on that, and but he couldn't help himself to have to explain it in a million different ways. I got it. He could have done it in one sentence. Should I post when it's raining, and what will that do?
You might have responded right away.
I probably would have responded right away. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so I guess my writing seminar didn't work for him. Sorry, guys. So you guys will have learned nothing today, but you learned how to do jazz hands if you didn't already know how to do that, so that's good. But you're right. So what I found interesting about it, it's kind of like old dog, new tricks. He's been writing that way for 40 years, and he met me, and we spent an hour together with among a bunch of other people, and now he's aware of it. So maybe three or four emails in will get him going where he needs to go. You know what? I might respond with only one sentence and teach him a lesson. Maybe. That probably is. She has a good point. It's probably only half of what he would have written.
Just do two words, boo and yes or no.
That's so true. I like that. Afterward, you guys can all come up here with me. We'll respond to him together. Okay, so email subject lines. The most important thing you need to do in an email is write the subject line. And if you're doing a newsletter, like if you guys do newsletters for your brands, calling it newsletter volume one or newsletter of the date or newsletter of the week or whatever it is doesn't inspire anybody to want to open it. Tease them about something that's in there that's going to make them want to open it. And you don't have to say everything that's in there. Tease them about something provocative. Redpoint sent around an email when we were launching something last year. We had a Facebook page and we were relaunching our Facebook page with new stuff on it. And we sent around an email to everybody that said, hugging tigers and making hooch. Come on. You have to open that. So did anybody notice what I just did? Yeah, see? I felt it click as I did. So do you remember when Diane introduced me yesterday and she said, if you go to my blog, you'll see a thing about why I won't wear boots at boot camp anymore? Can everybody see my boots? Mm-hmm. I'll walk around so you can see my boots. So are we getting a good shot, close-up of the boots?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good. All right. So I wore these boots recently at a boot camp that I do these marketing boot camps. And as you guys notice, I walk a lot. And then when I stand to answer a question, I tend to put my legs together. Well, the hooks in the front of this one got caught in there's like a finger loop back here. And I was sort of standing on the side. And then I went to move again, and I went, So these boots got hooked together. And because of the way they got hooked together, I might as well finish the story. You can't bend this way when they get hooked together. So I literally had to like do a dramatic waist bend to try to unhook them. And this poor young intern was sitting right in front of me. I think he was horrified. I was like, can you help me? So anyway, he was turned seven shades of red, poor kid. Anyway, I digress. Email subject lines. Super important, and if you have to spend any amount of time, if you only have 5 minutes to spend on an email, I would spend 3 of it on the subject line, and only 2 on whatever it is you're going to put in there. It's really important when you're talking about opening.
What was your email about? Well, I mean, I know it was about tigers and hooch.
Well, yes, it was about tigers and hooch. It was about the relaunch of our Facebook page, and we had put the photo albums that were on there. One of them was Red Point Team, because you guys know we travel a lot for a living, and so when we take vacations, we take amazing vacations, because we've already been to so many other places that we tend to go to a lot of exotic places. And so we had, one of the photos was Molly had gone to India and she was literally laying on top of a tiger. It's a great photo. It's a little scary, but it's a great photo. So we had that was one of the photos. And then the other one was, we have a client down in West Virginia, Smooth Ambler Spirits. I went down there to learn how to make vodka. So there's all these photos of me in the warehouse making hooch. So yeah, that was a really good trip. So later on, did anybody ever been to the Tractor Bar in West Virginia? Yeah, it used to be a tractor supply store, and the guy found that he could make more money by selling liquor. So he just put up a card table in the side of the tractor store and started like having his friends come in, and then ultimately it turned into a huge bar. So we went there, and that was fun. Anyway, that's for another day. It's a different kind of workshop. What's on your homepage? Literally and figuratively. When you think of a homepage for a website, it should be the most important stuff. But most of the time it isn't. It's like the boring blah, blah, blah is on the homepage of a lot of people's websites. You come here and we will show you that we are the most amazing, fantastic, wonderful people in the world. It's not catchy. And it doesn't make people want to go to the other pages. So you have to think about what is it that's on your homepage. And when I say literally and figuratively, I also mean when you're writing something, your homepage, in figurative terms, is like your subject line or your first sentence. It's like the first thing that people are going to see. Be concise. I love this sentence. Overwriting is the failure to make choices. If you just keep saying things more things, because you're not finding the right word, you're not choosing the right word, and you're not choosing the concepts that you want to put together. If you have too many things, too many messages for one piece of communication, nobody's going to achieve the goal. You won't get to the end, you won't get people to where you want to go because you're distracting them with too many different things. If you have too many messages for one piece of communication, break it up. Break it up into two, break it up into three, break it up into bullet points, break it up into paragraphs. Somehow show that there's a difference between the different concepts that you're trying to put together. A lot of times when you can't choose the right words, you end up saying more about the same subject. So you'll say, we have the most beautiful state, it is really idyllic, and it is also quintessential, and it is also peaceful, and it is also, and you just kind of keep going. And if you think about it, there's probably one sentence you can use that encapsulates all of that. So that's what, one of the things you want to be careful of. And we talked about the empty words. If you say things like best and great and phenomenal and all that, you'll find that you need to use a lot of other sentences to then further describe what it is you're trying to say. You got to stay focused on your goal. What doesn't belong? If it doesn't belong to help you achieving your goal, either the stated goal or the hidden goal, put it aside. And don't use it in whatever you're doing because it's just going to distract and make whatever it is you're sending or putting together to, you know, significantly longer. And the trick to being concise is merciless self-editing. Does anybody here ever edit their work by sort of sleeping on it and writing it, going back to it the next day with a red pen? Yeah, and you all said you're not good writers. Look at these fantastic habits you have. That's so important. You have to get really good at learning how to chop up your own work. Okay, this sentence sounds awkward. This phrase is too long. This is a little awkward. So that's when you start getting out your thesaurus and figuring out how you can shorten some of these phrases and make them more concise and more meaningful. I'm gonna give you guys, in fact, I didn't bring any handouts with me, but I'll post and I put up the site to my blog at the end so you guys all have it. I'm putting up some documents for you all that are self-editing tips, and writing tips and different kinds of things, so you'll be able to download those whenever you want. This is one of my favorite examples. So, you will delight in the beautiful landscape views available from your every window, and depending on the season, you may look out upon anything from a soft blanket of pristine white snow to a rainbow of colorful blossoms. I pulled that right off a hotel's website. They were actually in Vermont. Ha ha ha. You guys are all going to be searching the hotels in Vermont websites now to see who did it. I pulled this off last year. Hopefully it's different because hopefully they changed their website often. So the phrase, look at, you may look out upon anything from. These concepts, it gives you a good visual, no denying. You definitely walk away from here thinking it's picturesque, it's going to be, you know, beautiful colors, white snow, all of that stuff. So it gives a good visual, but it's awkward in its phrasing and it's fairly long. From the vibrant blossoms of spring to the gentle white blanket of winter, your windows provide a front row seat to nature's spectacular seasonal show. Now, the second phrase actually makes it sound like you've commanded God in the heavens to put on a show for your guests outside your window, which is a much different feeling and tone than this other one, which is basically all this stuff is out there and you can look at it if you want to. So, vibrant takes care of rainbow of colorful, which if you think about it, rainbow of colorful, it's kind of silly. It's totally redundant, right? So all of that kind of combines, and then what we've actually done here is gone from 3.5 lines to 2.5 lines, and much more impactful and much more meaningful. So what we've done is made choices in the words that we're choosing, and we've made choices in the descriptors that we're using so that we can be more impactful using a shorter amount, shorter sentences and fewer words. Where's my I woman? I love that you're never going to use the word I again. When you are writing, the most powerful writing is about the reader, not about the writer. So anytime you're writing, even if you're writing a letter to someone, a guest response to a guest complaint, there is a time. Let's temper the never use the word I. There is a time to use the word I when you need to make a connection, and there's a reason that you personally are responding to something. But your comments, your feelings, your emotions, generally speaking, shouldn't really matter, because if you want to make a connection with the reader, then whatever you're writing has to be about them. So you want to take your ego out of your writing. If you train yourself to use I less, this is a trick I use with a lot of people I do one-on-one writing coaching with. If you train yourself to use I less, try never to use it. Try to never, ever use the word I. And rephrase everything so you're not using the word I. So if it's, I am sorry that this happened to you, it might be, it's unfortunate that this happened to you. Or I am very excited about it. We. Absolutely, if you're representing your brand, use the word we. Or our entire team is excited about it. Or it is so exciting that this is happening. Rephrase things, take the word I out of it, and your writing will be much more powerful. Don't talk at people. You want to engage them by winning their interest. And also, when you think about how you're talking to them, you kind of have to not think about what you want to say, but you have to think more about what is it that my audience wants to hear? And how does my message dovetail with what they want to hear? So if it's the soccer, this is why knowing your audience is so important. If it's the soccer mom, if it's the golfer, if it's the skier, you know kind of basically what's going on in their mind. And then if you want to tell them how great and fantastic and wonderful your attraction, your hotel, your destination is, what you want to do is find a way to match what you have with what you know they want and not be pushing that information at them, but by delivering it to them in words that are going to be most meaningful for them. And to persuade someone else, you have to speak their language. You know, we talked about comfy, comfortable, and sumptuous, you know, great grub, decadent fare, and all of that. You need to speak in a language that's going to make a lot of sense to them. I don't think, this is where Facebook is at its, I guess this is one of the best examples I've ever seen. If you have a website and you have a Facebook page for your brand, you will use different tone and different phrasing for them. If you try to talk on Facebook to your fans, I call them fans even though they're likes. So it's just silly to say if you try to talk to your likes. So if you try to talk to your fans using promotional brochure-like language, you're doing the opposite of social media, right? It's not at all social. So you want to be more relaxed, more casual when you're talking to them in that space. A person might write a letter to your company and you might respond in a more formal tone. But when somebody says something to you on Facebook, you definitely want to be a little bit more casual in the way that you talk to them. Still professional, but otherwise it doesn't really belong in that arena. So you always want to try to be speaking the language of the group that you're talking to also within the arena that you're talking. And then finally, sort of the last thing you want to do with anything you're writing is what we would call wrapping it with a bow. How does it look on the page? It's another good way to tell whether or not you've written something too long. If you print it out and you hold it up and you don't get a lot of white space on the page, that's not a good sign. Definitely want to make sure there's a significant amount of white space on the page. You might break it up, like I said, by doing bullet points, by doing paragraphs, by a lot of times, this is a little trick we use in the PR world. We'll do, if we have a lot of information we want to deliver, like in a pitch to a journalist, we'll do the pitch or whatever the information is in a sort of a summary form, and then maybe put a line and put all the details down so they could check out the summary in the beginning and see whether or not they're interested. And if they are, all the information's there. Or attaching a link to a PDF, breaking something out, putting it in a different area, which is great. That also helps you track, so you can see how many people open the link. So that's always handy. Emails, I find that emails are the hardest thing for people to do, which is why I spend a lot of time focusing on them, because you write so many of them. But even writing two sentences of an email, if you want it to be persuasive, you still have to spend a few minutes thinking about what you want to say. So this idea of shortening things and making them, even though it's an email, some people open their email in a little box. Some people open it full screen. Some people only look at it in a little preview. I mean, you have no idea how people are receiving the information. So you want to make sure that however you do it, it also looks appealing to them. Where is the eye drawn on a page? I told you guys I read a lot of resumes. I have a lot of fun reading resumes. I'm sorry to admit this, we actually have a bulletin board in our office where we put some of the most hilarious ones. Because it's really funny. And one time one went up there when I didn't offer somebody the job. I didn't even interview him, but just, you know, said no thank you or whatever. Actually wrote me back a letter saying, I just made the most horrible mistake of my life. And he went on to rant about how we at least should have called him for an interview, and I thought, oh my God, I'm going to have a stalker. Anyway, that was a sidebar. Don't do that if you're looking for a job. It doesn't really win you any friends, just so you guys know. So we did have somebody write a cover letter to me not too long ago that actually randomly tabbed every other paragraph. So the first paragraph was indented five spaces, and then the second one wasn't, and the third one was, and then the fourth one wasn't. And I thought, are they trying to make this look like it was graphically designed or something? Because it was so weird, and you saw my passion for symmetry, right? It was killing me that this was off center when we first got in here, and I was trying all sorts. I ended up with a napkin, so I was trying all sorts of things to make it work. So it has to look like where my eye was immediately drawn to the random tabs on that side of the page, and so I ended up sort of not really concentrating on a lot of the messages that were being in there. Now that says a lot about me as a person, right? I mean, it might sound a little weird, actually. But we're friends, so I can admit all that with you. But at the same time, you know, you don't know what the person who is receiving the information, what's going to make them tick and what's going to make them look weird at something. So I spent a little bit of time trying to figure that out. And really what I should have been focusing on was that person's credentials. But it got in the way of doing that. Is the length appropriate for the message? To your point, I could answer that guy with boo, yes, or boo, no. There's no reason sometimes to write a dissertation. Or if somebody, especially if you're, somebody is taught, like a guest is complaining to you, I will tell you from my experience of dealing with a lot of difficult guests over time, they want you to respond with the same length that they sent to you. And somehow that makes them, it's almost scientific, because that sort of shows to them that you care about their problem as much as they cared in terms of writing it to you. So if they write a paragraph, you write a paragraph. If they write three paragraphs, you write three paragraphs. You can make them shorter. It doesn't have to be the same, but it almost needs to kind of match so that you're tying in with the gravity of the situation. I should do a study on that sometime, because I really think we could actually chart a bell curve on that or something. So should it have a design style? And that's something that's really important. We're not all graphic designers, but sometimes it's not about the words and the tone. Remember I was saying a picture is worth a thousand words? Sometimes the addition of a fantastic visual will help overcome any challenges you've had with the writing. Sometimes just making it not text on paper, but actually choosing a different font or adding some color or putting a frame, a border around the page. Sometimes those things really help give something a look and a design style that makes it better and more well received by the reader. And most importantly, does it reflect your brand? Does this match your brand's professionalism? Does this match the image that you want people to know about your brand? Does this in some way inspire people to make a connection with your brand? And even if you're just writing a letter, especially if you're doing an ad or some kind of marketing piece or a newsletter, you want it to look and feel like your brand so that anything else that they see that is tied to your brand gives them that same feeling, that same tone, and the same flavor. So your approach when you're writing, obviously, think carefully about your goal. Think about the mindset of your audience. If you're writing something that's a little bit difficult and you're procrastinating on it, you're having trouble getting started, jot down a reasonable number of key points that you think you could cover. Then go back and put them in order, because that's where your brain freezes when you try to order them and wordsmith them as you're getting them out on paper. So jot them all down first and don't worry about the order. Go back later and say, okay, this is my most important one. This is my second most important. And if I don't have a lot of room, these three, they're going. And I'll save them for something else. Your opening is essential. It's a transition from their world to your objectives. You're pulling that soccer mom out of her everyday life and transitioning in her into whatever it is you want to tell her. You always want to make sure that your document, your writing, whatever it is, flows and takes the reader on a journey from the beginning all the way to the end, even if it's a one paragraph email. So you want to make sure that you start them somewhere and you finish somewhere. And when you're writing, you got to think of it like you're orchestrating an experience. I know I'm elevating writing to something that seems a lot more important than it is, but you really want to be almost hospitable in the way you are writing for people and taking them on this journey and orchestrating it from beginning to end. The most important thing I could leave you with today is to sleep on it, especially when you have something important that you're writing. Sleep on it and go back and edit it the next day. And we don't always have the luxury of going home and actually going to sleep, but sometimes that could mean writing something in the morning, taking an hour or a break away from it and doing something else and coming back to it. You will be surprised at how different your point of view is the second time around and how easy it is for you to edit. So when you are on your own, fear not. It takes practice. And it's not the kind of thing that will flip a light switch and all of a sudden you'll be better at it overnight. I do have business cards up here, which you guys are welcome to take. If you're ever stuck on something and you're looking for just the right word, you shoot me an email. We'll bat around a couple of ideas, and I will give you back some phrasing. Use the self-editing sheet and the life cycle of drafting a document sheet, which I'm going to post on my blog as soon as we're done with this here today. They will help you. It's sort of like, if you're not finding the right phrase, here's what you should do. If you're finding that, you know, your tone sounds very emotional, here's what you should do. So there's a couple of different ifs, and here's what you should do on some of those things. And the life cycle of drafting a document sheet is literally steps of an order of here's what you need to do when you're drafting something. And I would suggest, and I kind of do this myself, although I've been doing this for so long now, I don't need to do it anymore, I have it memorized, is sort of keep it handy, and when you're about to write something really important, just look at that. Like, okay, these are the 8 things I need to do. And then it will remind you to do them, take some time, jot down your bullets, put them in order and all that stuff so that you don't forget. And then there really is no right way. It's great for me to stand up here and tell you guys all what to do. I don't get to do that very often, so I love doing that. But there really is no right way. I'm not the person who says that life cycle of drafting a document, if you do these 8 things, you'll be a perfect writer. You might have a whole different approach. You need to have an approach. Is the point. You need to figure out what works for you. It's like the way people manage their time. Everybody manages their time differently, although almost everybody I know says they're a list person. Are you guys all list people? I don't know anybody who manages their time without doing a list. Does anybody not do a list? Yeah, anyway. You and I need to chat. You're a very interesting person. You clearly buck the trend everywhere we go. There is no right way to do writing. It's whatever way comes naturally to you. And some of the suggestions that I made here today were to give you a little bit of an impetus and maybe some threads to help you become a better writer, but you need to find the way that makes the most sense for you. So, redpointspeaks.com is my blog, and there's a lot of things on there. The handouts from today are on there. There are some other, this blog is actually educational focused, although the story of my boots is actually on there, so you can see that. But I try to share tips that either I get during doing these kinds of presentations or things that I've seen, Subway ads that I've seen that are hilarious and have a funny story to them and how you should not do what they did, that kind of thing. So that's really what the focus of the blog is. It's not really about me telling you about my day. But there are some good writing posts on there, 8 ways to apologize without using the words I'm sorry, which come very handy for you, because we were talking about being trite before, right? And being when you say I'm sorry, I mean, we've all become desensitized to that, because we say it for I'm sorry your cat died, and I'm sorry, did you not hear what I was saying? And we say it so much that when we're actually sorry, it's like doesn't do our apology justice. So anyway, so there's that. Do you guys know what homophones are? Come on. Words that sound like other words, right? Like principle and principle? Right, but are spelled there, and there, right? They're spelled differently. And we all get them wrong all the time, even me. So anyway, there's a neat listing of all the homophones on there as well. And then I have this thing about exclamation points, as you all heard about before, so there's a posting there as well. But there's also the story of my coffee, guys. Lessons that I've learned from potato chips, right? Because who doesn't love potato chips? And then the boot incident and a lot of stories from the subway. And so I will post the 2 documents this afternoon. So if you guys want to download them at any time, that would be great. And so does anybody have any questions? You guys were great. Do we have a question?
If you don't like exclamation points, and I'm very guilty of using them. But, you know, it's the way that I express smiling
Yep.
I use
yes.
How do you get away from doing that?
Yeah. Well, there is a time and a place to use them. And so when I say give them a break, what I mean is make sure you're using them at the appropriate time and place. So when you want to show joy about something, sometimes 20 exclamation points is really the only way to get out the joy that you want to show. Other times, it's really because you haven't really thought about the right word. So I'm so happy followed by 20 exclamation points could be I'm ecstatic, or you know, there's another way to say what you want. And in business is really where it's more important. Like when I'm writing to my nephews, I can't tell you, I've gone over my texting limit with exclamation points on to my 14-year-old nephew, right? You scored the winning goal, right? But when I'm writing to an editor at the New York Times, and I want to show my joy and appreciation over what they were doing, I try to curb my exclamation point use as much as possible. So it's really about knowing when to use them and knowing when it's better to take your time to choose a different word that expresses your meaning in a more impactful way. Do we have any other questions? You guys were great. Thank you for coming here today. Thank you so much. I feel like you guys are like my family now. This is great, 2 years in a row.
You'll be skiing next year.
Thank you, I'll be skiing next year. Right, oh good, fantastic, I love it. Okay, so I have cards up here. If you guys have any questions about any of the stuff I had yesterday, I didn't put my email up yesterday, I just thought that would have been a little much, but you, writing, social media, whatever, any follow-up questions or anything like that, feel free to email me at any time and I will be happy to respond, but make sure your subject line is punchy and powerful so that I make sure I open it, all right? Okay, good. You guys, on your merry way. Yeah, comment on my boots.